My name is Veroš. I have some Twitter, so you can write me to Twitter. We have some website, and I have my some web page. You can write me something on it. And what I'm doing for my work, usually I'm fixing, and from time to time I am also breaking servers. Either I'm doing it manually, like connecting to server by SSH, writing some commands and breaking it, and it then works or doesn't work. And I found some automation tools or config management tools. So usually I'm trying to automate my way of working. So I'm using Puppet, Ansible, or something like that. And how my typical workflow looks? Usually I have got some broken server, it's set server, because our customers calls us, it doesn't work, it's broken, it's on fire. And then my task is to convert that broken set server to a new happy server, and the arrow between the broken and new server, it's my work. By the way, how many of you are developers? How many people are developers here? So you are dev people, and how many of you are ops people, or trying to operations? Okay, thank you. It's smaller half are ops, bigger half are devs. So, but this workflow I shown on the slides, it's ideal workflow. In the real workflow is, I have set server, I try to fix it, I usually broke it, and I create even more broken server. So I have very set server, and if I'm happy guy, I will convert the set very bad server to happy server. Usually it doesn't work, and I have few iterations how to do of broken servers or broken server, and it's not so good. So do you know this famous slide, this famous man? It's Chuck Norris, yes. Usually he doesn't, Chuck Norris, he has some superpowers. He usually doesn't test code, and when he tests, he does it in production. But compared to me, he has some superpowers of debugging. Usually he stares to his machines, he stares to his servers until it fixes itself. I tried it, I failed. So, if you read any book or anything about system administration or about programming, you will run into it works on my machine saga. When you have some developers, we have very nice developer guys all around the world, especially in Europe, and they say, well, that software works on my machine. I tried it. Let's see. But it's here, it's the left part, it's on the laptops, it works. But from time to time you will run into issues on the server, on the production machines. There are some different versions of applications, different versions of operating system, and it doesn't work. So what it means? It means that we need some testing before applying any change to or before introducing any changes to broken servers or to deploy to production servers, we should have some testing servers. It's nothing new, it's said. And then when it works on testing server, we should deploy it in the production. Still, no problem, it's easy. So, conclusion, we need testing environment. Well, how many of you have, or is there anybody, any brave person or who doesn't have testing environment? So brave person, brave man. Okay. Well, is there some brave or not so brave person, but still brave person who have only one testing environment? Right. Then one, so yeah, two, no problem. Usually the problem with testing environment or with one testing environment is that when you have testing environment and you test something on that, you usually broke it. It's great because you didn't break production. But then you have broken testing environments and nobody can test on it when you are when it's broken. So it means that we need more testing environments, not only one, we need two, four, ideally one testing environment for each developer. If you have very productive developers, maybe you should get two or three testing environments per developer. As there was great presentation from Bushra, she presented here some automating tools like Ansible. So it's quite these days it's quite easy. You can just prepare your playbooks or Ansible playbooks or Puppet manifests, and you can prepare your testing environments automatically, and you can kill it and start it like kettles. Is the famous talk about pets and kettles. You just destroy your testing environments and start it again. So, and it would be great. It's from time to time it's really hard to provide your developers access to testing environment because you don't have enough power. And then, so you can use for testing environment, you can use some VirtualBox, you can use Docker, you can use KVM, you can use, I don't know, DigitalOcean, anything. But one very nice tool you probably know or is Vagrant. By the way, who here doesn't use Vagrant? Everybody. Great. So the rest of people who, if you used Vagrant, probably you can leave. You will don't get any new knowledge. Sorry. Well, the Vagrant itself, it's a software from HashiCorp. It's company of Michel Hashimoto. If you will check their web page, you will probably find that they are trying to conquer the world, because they every year they prepare a new open source software, which will move or which prepares some testing or some DevOps tool. Vagrant is one of the oldest softwares from HashiCorp. In fact, it's only wrapper about VirtualBox or some virtualization environment. How it works? When your developers tell you, well, we need testing environment, you will just prepare some Vagrant file. Let's see. Is it large enough, or should I? Is it readable at the last line, last row? Okay. Not now. Better. So when you start with Vagrant, you will just create some Vagrant file. It's some small Ruby file. You will say, I want to, let's see, it's called Vagrant file. You will just say, I want to configure Vagrant, is the wrapper. I would like to build a box based on some template box. This template box is provided by VStone, it's my colleague. You will say, I would like to provide that virtual machine with 1 gigabyte of memory, and I would like to run some commands on it. So let's check. Is the Vagrant file? I would like to Vagrant status. Vagrant machine is running, okay. So I will destroy it and start again. The Vagrant itself is wrapper, so now I will try run Vagrant status. It will say the default virtual machine isn't created. So now I will start Vagrant run. It's another command of Vagrant wrapper. It will, okay. Vagrant up, run. When I write Vagrant up, it will found the pre-prepared Vagrant box, the virtual machine box. It will push that box to VirtualBox on my as I'm running VirtualBox on my machine. It will do some setup on it, like setting name of the virtual machine, like setting port, like forwarding ports, the SSH port on the guest machine will be forwarded to my laptop, and the port 80 will be forward it also to my laptop to another port. It will boot the machine. It will do some additional magic. And in the Vagrant file, as you see, there are some commands which will install Nginx, will start Nginx, and add the HTTP to add the HTTP port to enabled ports. So let's start it. And now, if everything is okay, I will try to connect to Vagrant Box. It works. Unbelievable. Well, easy. I'm at bat window. So by quite easy, by one prepared file and one command, I'm able to start the virtual machine. I can run some commands on it. I can even broke it if I don't like it. I can run some experiments on it. I can try to fix the machine if it's broken. I can try some super clever idea I have got, like inventing perpetual mobile in software, something like that. It will work. Well, using shell scripts for provisioning your machines isn't so good, isn't preferred idea. So, if you know Puppet, it's just another config management tool. Provision. Puppet can be applied to your machine by some manifests. It's just file with extension pp, and I wrote to the machine, I want that file etc motd message of the day and I would like to that this file should be present, and it should contain some files or some string. So vagrant up. Will happen. Again, the machine will be started, provisioned with Puppet. It's 90%. The Vagrant, if you are running VirtualBox, it does some magic with SSH. It will connect to the virtual machine, put some SSH keys into it, it will create SSH key on your machine and put the public part to the target machine, and you can connect there, and you can run your commands. Well, now it's running Puppet. The last line is running Puppet. These messages are from Puppet, and it will say it was applied. And now, when I will connect to the machine by command vagrant SSH. I will be connected to the target machine, to the guest machine. It will do some magic at background, and say, I'm at machine, and as you see, I have got welcome message. The message of the day will be presented to me when I connect to the machine. Still no magic. If you don't like. Well, I will destroy it. If you don't like the machine, you can destroy it. I will destroy it. I don't need it anymore. Vagrant destroy. Yes, I will. I'm through. If you like, if you don't like Puppet, or if your organization is using Ansible, no problem. You can just write Vagrant file. You will say. I want to provision this machine by Ansible. The playbook of Ansible is in directory provision site YAML. I will start tmux and vagrant up. And we can now check at the second window. We can check the provision file, how it looks. The playbook says, I want to install Nginx, I want to start it, and I want to enable port 80. It's the shell script. The advantage of using Puppet or Ansible to provision the Vagrant boxes is that usually when you have some production and production environment or testing environment, you usually use, or your ops people use Puppet or Ansible to provide that production environment. So by using same config files, you can provision your virtual machine, your test virtual machine, in the same shape as your production. That's probably the biggest advantage of Ansible. No, of biggest advantage of not Docker. Too many buzzwords today. Vagrant, thank you. So, let's see. Now the Vagrant started Ansible provisioning and it's running. Let's check. It should listen on of port 7083. So let's check. Does it? It's present. So by simple command Vagrant up, I just provisioned the machine. The examples used here are really easy. In real life, you will probably provision some larger or bigger machines. So let's go back. Presentation. So it's quite easy. When you have simple web application, you have one server and two users, and it works. No problem. But when some other users appears, you usually start to prepare to use not only a web server, but also you will go to dedicated database. You can, and when some other people appears, you can double your database servers, you can double your web servers or something like that. And Vagrant is able to run this configuration too. So let's check. The command is same, it's Vagrant up, but you will add some parameters. I will destroy this small machine, Vagrant destroy. I'll destroy this example. It's multi-host. Now the Vagrant file looks slightly different. I will say, all my machines should be provided by VirtualBox. They should be provided by Puppet, and I want to define virtual machine Django 01 and virtual machine Postgres 01. There are some parameters and so on, and all these machines should be provided by Puppet. Again, you can use the same Puppet manifest as you are using for your production. So, what will happen? And I will write Vagrant status. Okay. Now Vagrant told me that I have two machines which I should deploy. If I will fire up command Vagrant up, both machines should be prepared. So let it happen. If I would try to start only one of the machines, I will ask Vagrant to write Vagrant up Django 01, Vagrant up Postgres 01. Control B. The provision. Okay. I'm with the directory. 04 multi-host. Provision site PP. Again, I created a fake example. I haven't installed Django and Postgres to that machine. I only updated the message of the day. So now Vagrant is starting Django machine. It's installed, and now it's installing Postgres. So when I will write Vagrant status, the machine Django is running, the machine Postgres is still provisioned. So Vagrant SSH Django 01. What will happen? Well, I'm at Slovak Technical University, Bratislava. Okay. So the machine has been provisioned and it works. It's 5 minutes to end. Okay. So it works. You can trust me. So how developers can use Vagrant. I have still some images from presentation of my colleague. If you are a developer, you will find yourself in state when you install this random package and that package and a lot of software to your machine. And if you use Vagrant or some other solution, you can separate all these machines, all these small machines, and run them in virtual machines or something like that. No problem. So it would be great if the Vagrant will be silver bullet. It isn't, sorry. There is a lot of other tools which can be used instead of Vagrant. As you saw, the Vagrant out of the box uses VirtualBox, which is quite slow. Well, it's good for my machine, it works, but some production, or if you want to be faster, you can ask Vagrant to run at KVM against Amazon cluster. You can ask Vagrant to start your instances on DigitalOcean, even on Docker. I have been told that every presentation should contain word Docker, so now I did. Yeah. And also, as I told, Vagrant is quite old technology. Last year, I don't know, it was September, ninth month, the HashiCorp prepared a robot which is called Otto. I definitely recommend to look to it. I have no time yet to dig into it very deeply, but it knows some best practices for deploying your machine for development. So it works. It's for some tasks it can be considered successor of Vagrant, and it can also does some isolation, like AutoDev will prepare your development environment and AutoDeploy should deploy your machine to somewhere. But as I told, I never tried that, but it's also quite interesting tool. So the machine is already deployed. You can trust me, it works. So now probably it's time for questions and answers. No, I'm not able to switch them.
So Docker again.
What's the advantage of Vagrant over Docker? Well, I'm ops guy. I'm not a dev guy. So from time to time, I need to deploy to test some software or some configuration when I need to run some kernel modules and so on. Docker is not able to does that to run it. And Docker will never change your kernel. But of course, for some deployments, the Docker is really a good task. But if you want to provide some development environment to your developers, from my ops guy, I will put my ops hat on my head. If you want to provide some development or something environment to your developer guys or girls, then it's much easier to provide them virtual machine, and it will be easier for them to write Vagrant app and it will be run. If you are brave, if you are able to prepare the virtual machine or the environment with Docker, no problem. I am using Docker for some tasks, and I really appreciate it. The Docker container startup is blazingly fast, of course. I hope I answered. Or feel free to talk at corridors, tea, coffee, or something like that.
Good. So, do you test your code in production?
Am I supposed to answer?
I think it was a joke. Uh-huh, so. What DevOps means to you, and what are its main advantages? Because you said you were a proponent of this movement.
Well, I'm known that I don't know what DevOps is. I've used to be deaf, and now I'm sitting at Ops. So my colleagues told me that I'm DevOps. DevOps is approach to developing and deploying software. It's not a new job title. It's not a new department. It's not a new software. I think it's approach. For some people, it's also religion.
So next one, who supports or updates the original pre-made images used by Vagrant?
I used image prepared by my colleague, so I know that he will prepare the image for me. We have some scripts or some CI which will build the new boxes for us. And the difference between Docker and Vagrant boxes. To build a Docker machine or to build base Docker container or base Docker image, you need to install some machine and to pick it up. And for example, preparing CentOS base image, you have to install the machine to clean it and then to archive it to image. While in Vagrant, it's same. You just install your machine, clean it, and package it. Usually we prepare our boxes itself. We have some CI tool for that.
So next one, how much RAM are those virtual machines consuming?
Well, this question is of course from some Docker fan, I expect. It's virtual machine, so when you run your VirtualBox here, you will say that the machine at VirtualBox eats 1/2 of gigabyte of RAM, but it can be configured, no problem. What happened? Should I? No. It's not important. It's just number.
Good. And the last question. Why do you use Puppet and Ansible? It's like two different configuration and you need more config for your deployment.
Well, the question is why I'm using Puppet and Ansible. The Puppet and Ansible, there are two great tools which each is good at its own. In this presentation I used Puppet and Ansible just to show that Vagrant isn't bound to a specific tool. You can provision your virtual machines at Vagrant by shell scripts, by Puppet, by Ansible, by Chef, by Ansible Local, by whatever you need, because Vagrant is quite extensible. We are using Puppet for big projects, and I'm personally using Ansible for some small projects of mine. So it's no problem.